أن الإمام الحميدي رحمه الله تعالى he mentions ولا قول وعمل ونية إلا بسنة. There's no speech, no action, when a person makes an intention, except that it has to be in accordance to the Sunnah. If a person does any action or says any speech, even if his intentions are very nice, if this person's actions don't go in accordance to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or his speech or his intention, then this person gets his action or whatever he's doing rejected. So brothers, we have to understand that every action has three conditions. Every action that we do has three conditions. The first condition is that this person needs to be Muslim. وَمَنْ يَبْتَغْ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْ. Whoever now tries to desire other than the religion of Islam, it won't be accepted from him. The second condition, he needs to have sincerity. He needs to have the correct intention when he's performing the action. And we mentioned previously that otherwise this person gets nothing. Based upon the other hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِنِيَاتِ أَيْ لَا يُقْبَلُ أَيْ عَمْلِ إِلَّا بِنِيَّةِ. No action is accepted except with the correct intention. The third condition, it has to be in accordance to the sunnah. Our religion is not emotions or excitement or one feeling unhappy if something goes against his desires. Even though that it might look to be something good in front of your eyes, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he mentioned كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَإِنْ يَرَاهَ النَّاسُ حَسَنًا وَإِنْ يَرَاهَ النَّاسُ حَسَنًا. Every innovation is a misguidance, even if the people see it to be something good. So the Mawlid now, for example, if a person is performing the Mawlid, the celebration of what? The birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they're chanting down the road, getting all emotional about it. We love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Without a doubt, loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is something that is part of our religion. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والدي وولدي والناس أجمعين. One is not a true believer until he loves me more than his parents, his children, and the people in totality altogether. So these people that come up to you and they love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and perhaps in reality they love him, they really like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But at the same time, we have to ask ourselves, this action I'm doing, is it truly an action that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is satisfied with? A whole ayah came down, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Say to them, O Muhammad, if you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow me. Hassan al-Basri, he called this Ayatul Mihna, the verse of examination. And he said, زَعَمُوا أَنَّهُمْ يُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَابْتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِهَذِهِ الْآيَةِ. Some people thought and claimed that they loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he tested them with this ayah. So when you're doing this action, does it go in accordance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So the Mawlid, for example, going back to the Mawlid, they make apparent love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, salawat, sending salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then bringing إِنَّ اللَّهُ مَلَائِكَةُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ مَنْ صَلَّ عَلَيَّ صَلَاةٍ وَاحِدًا صَلَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ بِعَشَرًا. Whoever sends one salutation upon me, Allah will send down upon him 10 salutations. Do you understand what I'm saying, brothers? So, because there is some ahadith in some of the actions they might be doing, and based upon the emotions, they have taken this as a path, as an act of worship. But because in the way it is done, specifying something in your religion, even though it might have a hadith to it, but specifying it for a specific occasion, it becomes a bid'ah. It's as if we are only showing love to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on what? One day. So if you truly love something, what happens? You only show love to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once a year. Is that true love? And the statement of Hassan al-Basri was from the tremendous of the tabi'in. Some people thought they loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah azza wa jal. But he tested them with this ayah. So if you truly love Allah azza wa jal, then do what he's told you to do. Stay away from what he told you to stay away from. Our religion, ikhwani, brothers and sisters, our religion is perfect. Our religion is perfect. Every single detail, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way he kissed his wives, the way he drank milk, the way he drank water, the way he had intercourse with his wives, all of that has been mentioned. The way he slept, the way he woke up, what he mentioned, when going inside the toilet, when coming out, the smallest of the details, what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read when going to bed. Every single detail has been mentioned. A Jewish man came to Salman al-Farisi. And look what he said to Salman al-Farisi. قَدْ عَلَّمَكُمْ نَبِيُّكُمْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى الْخِرَاءَ. Your Prophet has taught you everything. Even how to use a toilet. Al-Khira'a is hayat. يعني what do they call it? Hayat. يعني the way to use the toilet. The way to use the toilet. How to sit down or what to do and things like that. There was an explanation that Imam al-Nawawi mentioned that I forgot at the very moment. نعم. على كل, the point is, Al-Khira'a is the way to use the toilet. So this Jewish man says to Salman al-Farisi, your Prophet told you, even how to use the toilet. So Salman al-Farisi goes, أجل, نعم, أمرنا أن لا نستقبل القبلة عند التغوّد. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us not to face the qibla when you're doing number two, when you're doing number one. في حالة الغائب وكذلك في حالة البول. And not to use أقل من ثلاثة أحجار, or to use under three stones when washing yourself. وأن لا نستنجي باليمين. And not to wash ourselves with our right hand. So if this is now a Jewish man, even the Jewish man has what? Acknowledged and seen. It has come clear to him that the religion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been completed. And that the Prophet explained every single detail. And the whole ayah came down. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. The day when I perfected you, or completed your religion. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Allah says, ما فرطنا في الكتاب من شيء. We haven't neglected anything from the book. And this hadith, إخواني, is a backbreaker. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned, ما تركت شيئا يقربكم إلى الله ويبعدكم عن النار إلا وقد بينته لكم. There's not something that gets you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and furthers you away from the fire except that I have clarified it to you. I haven't left a thing that gets you closer to Allah. And it came another hadith of Sahih Muslim. إنه لم يكن نبي قبلي إلا كان حقا عليه أن يدل أمته على خير يعلمه لهم. There never came a messenger before me except that it was mandatory. It was a right upon him to explain to his ummah and to show them of every single good deed. وأن ينذرهم عن شر يعلمه لهم. And every evil that he knows about, that he clarifies to them. So if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now totally forgot, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgot to mention in the Quran, and Allah says, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا, your Lord wasn't forgetful. The Sahaba who loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than anyone upon this earth, why didn't they wake up one day and say, today we're going to make the celebration, celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the time of the four a'immah, nobody ever done it. The time of Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Ahmed, the Muhaddithin, Imam Abu Dawood, Imam al-Nisa'i, Imam ibn Majah, all this time, they never did the Mawlid. Someone comes after all these years with his own fikrah, his own idea, and innovates something in the religion. What's the difference now? I can wake up tomorrow, let's celebrate the birthday of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and do the exact same thing that the Christians do when it comes to Jesus, the 25th of December. We're going to appoint what? The day of Ashura, we're going to celebrate Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's birthday. Because it's the day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa from Fir'aun. And likewise with Salih alayhi salatu wasalam, with Yusuf, the day when he was taken out of prison, let's celebrate the celebration of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. It will open a very wide door. It will open a very wide door. And our religion will become like the religion of the Nasara. Any Tom, Dick and Harry comes and he adds whatever he wants and he takes away whatever he wants. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ الْحَافِظُونَ This Qur'an will be preserved إِلَىٰ قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ If there was any good in anything, even if it looks to us that something, mashallah, Ibn Umar mentioned, كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَإِنْ يَرَاهَا النَّاسُ حَسَنَةً Every bid'ah is a misguidance, even if the people see it to be something good. So you have the statement of Abdullah ibn Umar, which should be written in ma'i dahab, in golden ink, because you have the tafsir of the Salaf, Abdullah ibn Umar. And you find some people, they say that Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he split the bid'ah into five sections. Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he was an imam. But he was mistaken in this. And the ulama, they clarified this and they mentioned, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ كُلُّ مِنْ أَلْفَادِ الْعُمُومِ كُلُّ means all types of innovations and misguidance. So this word كُلُّ, this word كُلُّ, whether it's good, whether it's evil, it all goes under it. Until you have a dalil now that specifies it, that there's a good bid'ah. And you also have the statement of Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the tafsir of the Sahaba, who saw this. Is that clear, Khwan? So every single thing has been clarified, brothers. We're not in need of any guy to come today and innovate or bring about a new practice into our religion. We have 15 more minutes, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to start the chapter of al-Sahaba. وَالْتَرَحْهُمْ مُعَلَىٰ أَصْحَابِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كُلِّهِمْ And asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on all of his companions. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ قَالَ وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِنَا الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَا بِالْإِيمَانِ And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions those that have come after them, meaning after the Sahaba, they say, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا Oh Allah, forgive our brothers who have preceded us in al-Iman. So they make dua for them. They love them. They have affection. They ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with them. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبِعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ Allah is satisfied with them and they are satisfied with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The virtues of the Sahaba is many in the Quran. نعم and in the Ahadith أكثر من أن تحصى Many hadith you'll find which talk about the fadl of some of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So who's a sahabi? A sahabi, كما عرف ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى من لقي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم Whoever met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم مؤمنا به ومات على الإسلام And he believed in him. So the first condition is that he met. And he believed in the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. ومات على الإسلام. So the third condition is, and he died upon an Islam. And he died upon an Islam. These are the three conditions of who a Sahabi is. And then he also mentions, ولو تخللت الردة على الأصح. Imam ibn Hajar al-Asqalani in his kitab Nukhbat al-Fikr. So he met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He believed in him and he also died upon al-Islam. So if someone met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam but he didn't believe in him, does he become a Sahabi? Because he never believed in him. If a person believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam but then apostated, this person is not a Sahabi. Like what happened to Ibn Khattab. نعم. طيب. What if a person now, he believed in the Prophet ﷺ and he met him. And he apostated. And then maybe after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he became a Muslim. Does he keep his صحبة, his companionship? There's an اختلاف on the issue, but the outweighed opinion is that he is still a Sahabi. Like the example of Ash'ath ibn Khays, رضي الله عنه. You still find that the ulama, people like Ibn Hajar in his kitab al-Isaba, who still say that he is a Sahabi. At the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was a normal companion upon al-Islam. And then he apostated. And then in the time of Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه, he was brought to Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه when war broke out. And he entered into al-Islam. And Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه got him married off to one of his sisters. So Ash'ath ibn Qays re-entered into al-Islam after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So his suhbah was still there, his companionship was still there. طيب. What about a person who was there at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he never met him? Like Uwais al-Qarni, what do we call him? There's a tabaqa between the tabi'i and also the sahabi. Something called al-mukhadram. Something called al-mukhadram. And when the studies of Mustal al-Hadith, maybe the kitab al-Bayquni and the one after al-Nukhbat al-Fikr and Bahith al-Hadith, you'll find these kind of terminology. A mukhadram is someone that didn't mean the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but at the same time he was there in his time and he believed in him as well. So someone like Uwais al-Qarni, na'am, he is known to be a mukhadram. Also you find some of the ulama, they say tabi'i, but they say there's a tabaqa. The level between the Sahabi and the Tabi'i is someone that was there at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he did end up meeting him. So Mu'ayy, tell me, what's a mukhadram? Muhammad. They meet him. We call him mukhadram. Tabaqa between the Sahabi, we don't call him a Sahabi. So man talat majalisahu. So a Sahabi Ikhwani is someone that whether he sat with the Prophet ﷺ for a long time or qasurat, even if he sat with him for a very short time. وَمَنْ رَوَى عَنْهُ أَوْ لَمْ يَرْوِ عَنْهُ, whoever narrated from him or never narrated from him. وَمَنْ غَزَى مَعَهُ أَوْ لَمْ يَغْزُو, even the one that went out with the Prophet ﷺ in an expedition or he never went out. وكذلك من لم يراه لعارض كالعمى, or even the one that met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم but he wasn't able to see him due to there being a barrier, like Ibn Umm Maktum, who used to make the adhan. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is mentioned in the Bilal and يؤذن لكم بالليل وكلوا واشربوا حتى يؤذن Ibn Umm Maktum. He used to make the adhan. He was blind. And do we still say he's a prophet? Astaghfirullah, not a prophet. Do we still say that he's a sahabi? Na'am, we say he's a sahabi because he met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, believed him and he died as a Muslim. Is that clear, ikhwan? And brothers, we have to believe into three matters. We have to believe in three matters when it comes to the sahaba. وجوب التراضي والترحم. It is mandatory to be pleased and make dua for them and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be satisfied with all of the sahaba. That's the first belief we have regarding the sahaba. وجوب التراضي والترحم. Second one, الكفّ عما شجر بينهم. To stay away and abstain from any of the things that happened between them. Sometimes there were maybe quarrels and disputes that happened between the Sahaba. We have to stay away from it. We don't indulge in that which took place between them. The third thing, loving the close relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ahlul Bayt, Ahl Bayt. The close relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is mandatory that we have affection and love towards them. So you have these three matters that we have to believe when it comes to the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi alayhim. وجوب التراضي والترحم. To love them, all the Sahaba. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be satisfied with them. Second one, wujub al-kaffu amma shajara baynahum. To abstain, it is mandatory to abstain from the things that took place between the Sahaba. So if there was a dispute, for example, between Muawiyah and Ali radiallahu anhum, they are both great companions. We don't get involved, stay away from it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ قَالَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ وَلَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. They are people that have gone. And they have now reached that which they used to do. They will be held to account for whatever they used to do. وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ and you have what you do as well. وَلَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا كَانُوا and you won't be asked about that which they used to do. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is also considered, the ulama they say, Khalifa al-Khamis. Na'am? He said that this ayah is regarding the Sahaba khalas have gone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven them. You don't get involved. You don't get involved. And the fada'il, ikhwani, of the Sahaba are many. Who was the best of the Sahaba? The best of the Sahaba after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu bi ittifaq. Unanimously agreed was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And today, brothers, don't think that this is something that is clear cut between the people. The Rafida, they hate Abu Bakr. That guy called Yasir Habib. Anyone knows Yasir Habib? Yasir Habib got kicked out of Kuwait. He's now in London. From the dirtiest of the Shia, he will say, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah wa anna Aliyan, wa li Allah wa anna Husaynan wa ila akhirah, wa anna Aba Bakr wa Umar, wa anna Aba Bakr wa Umar, wa Uthman wa Ashad fi al-Nar." He added that to the Shahada. And he's now here in London. MashaAllah, when he came and he got kicked out, Britain, they gave him shelter. They opened up a TV channel for him. He gets recorded and he's all over YouTube cursing the Sahaba. In his prayer, he's cursing the Sahaba. And they're recording him and they're putting this all over the internet. The whole shahid is, the Rafida, wallahi brothers, don't think that this is a concept that we can't be afflicted with. Our own Somali brothers in Cricklewood in West London are being afflicted by this ideology. Seen in my own eyes. They bring a Shia to the masjid, he's giving da'wah. None of us are safe, and this is unheard of in the Somali community. طيب. How do we know that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the best of the companions? Firstly, there's a unanimous agreement. Also, that simply because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Aisha radiallahu anha to make him lead the prayer just before he died. Also, Abdullah ibn Umar, he mentioned, and the hadith, this narration is in Bukhari. This narration is in Bukhari. And a statement of the Sahabi, Ridwanullahi alayhi, if it wasn't said by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we call it a narration that is mawquf. This is just a side benefit that he was telling in the hadith. Sahib al-Bayquniya, he mentions, وَمَا أَضَفْتَهُ إِلَى الْأَصْحَابِ مِنْ قَوْلٍ وَفِعْلٍ فَوْمَوْقُوفٍ زُكِيٍ. Whatever you ascribe to a Sahabi, whether it's a statement or an action, we call it mawquf. This narration is mawquf. Any action of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أُضِيفَ لِلنَّبِي الْمَرْفُوعُ وَمَا لِتَابِعٍ هُوَ الْمَقْتُوعُ. Any narration that is ascribed to the Prophet from his actions or his speech, we call it marfu'. So this narration now is mawquf على Abdullah ibn Umar. He mentioned, كُنَّا نُخَيِّرُ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فِي زَمْنِ نَبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم. We used to choose from amongst the Sahaba in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَنُخَيِّرُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ ثُمَّ عُمَرٍ ثُمَّ عُثْمَانٍ. So we used to choose Abu Bakr, meaning to be the most superior, then Umar, then Uthman. The Rafida that make you believe that what? The rejection is also called the Shia. That Ali radiallahu anhu hated Abu Bakr and that he was against him, that he didn't agree to his khilafah at all. another narration in Sahih al-Bukhari, and this is a leg breaker. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiya, he was one of the sons of Ali radiallahu anhu. And he was only born when? In the Khilafah of Umar ibn al-Khattab. He asked his father, if Ali radiallahu anhu really hated Abu Bakr, all this time has just passed, Abu Bakr is dead radiallahu anhu. You're in the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab. At least now, if you really hated something, it's going to become now apparent on your tongue. And you're only telling your son. Sometimes you can hide stuff from the people, but your son, you're going to tell him the truth. His son asked him, أَيُّ النَّاسِ خَيْرِ. This narration also in Bukhari. أَيُّ النَّاسِ خَيْرِ بَعْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Who is the most, who's the one that has, how can I try? Who's the best? نعم. Who is the best after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? Ali radiallahu anhu replies, Abu Bakr. ثُمَّ مَنْ? His son says, who then? Umar ibn al-Khattab. So his son says, I was scared that he's going to say, نعم, Uthman ibn Affan. So I said to him, you, ya, O father. He goes, لا, ما أنا إلا رجل من المسلمين. I am only a man, just like the rest of the men. Out of tawadu, out of humbleness. So if Ali radiallahu anhu really hated, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, would he say to his son, in the khilaf of Umar ibn al-Khattab, that the best one after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Abu Bakr? And this narration is in Bukhari. So you have Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, then Umar ibn al-Khattab, the man who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the truth upon his tongue. That shaytan used to be scared of him. ما لقيك الشيطان سالكا فجا إلا سلك فجا غير فجك. Never did the shaytan ever meet you in a path except that the shaytan what? Took another path. The shaytan used to be scared of Umar ibn Khattab. And then you have Uthman ibn Affan, who was married to two of the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Dhul Nurayn, and then Ali radiallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned about Ali radiallahu anhu, أَمَا تَرْضَى أَن تَكُونَ مِنِّي بِمَنْزِلَةِ هَارُونَ مِنْ مُوسَى. And do you not want to be in the same position as Harun was when he came to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? So some of them, they said, خلاص, this is proof now. This is proof that Ali radiallahu anhu, he was deserving of the khilafah more than anyone else. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said to him, do you not now want to be in the position as Harun alayhi salatu wasalam was in the with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? This is a doubt that they bring. Brothers, this is a doubt. Pay attention. How do we explain this hadith? How do we explain this hadith? Because Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was the leader, and the one that was in number 2 was who? Harun alayhi salatu wasalam. And here, the Prophet is hitting an analogy, bringing an analogy. Do you not want to be in the same position that Harun was with Musa, and you're like this with me? Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions. Firstly, we have to know that Harun was only Musa's number 2 in his lifetime. Because Harun died before Musa bil-ittifaq. He was only his what? His number 2 in his lifetime. And he was never ever his number 2, or he wasn't appointed to be his number 2 after his death, because he died before him. And the fact that someone is your number 2 in this dunya or at your lifetime doesn't necessitate that you're going to be the number 2 in the after your death. So the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, even if we know sallamna jadalan, that Ali radiallahu anhu was the number 2, the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim, they were all in agreement. They used to choose amongst them. Aisha radiallahu anha, even after him, Abdullah ibn Umar, they all knew that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was the best and more superior than anyone else. So you have these four that are the best. Number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. Then you have the Asharat al-Mubashirin, who come after them in Fadila. The Asharat al-Mubashirin. The 10 who were given glad tidings of a Jannah. Hadith Sa'id ibn Zayd, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, Asharatu fil Jannah. 10 are in the Jannah. أبو بكر في الجنة، عمر في الجنة، عثمان وعلي في الجنة، والزبير وطلحة وعبد الرحمن ابن عوف، وأبو عبيدة وسعد بن أبي وقاص. All these nine are in the Jannah. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to him. فعد هؤلاء تسعة وسكت عن العاشر. He kept quiet before mentioning the tenth. فقال القوم ننشدك الله يا أبا الأعور من العاشر. نشدتموني بالله أبو الأعور في الجنة. Abu al-A'war, the one that was narrating the hadith, Sa'id ibn Zaydin, radiyallahu anhu, and this hadith was narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi, all these ten have been given glad tidings of al-Jannah. So you find that them four are the four most superior. Then after them, those that come in fadl, in virtue, are the rest of the six. And also you have another sahabi, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas mentioned, ما سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول يحيي يمشي إلى في الجنة إلى عبد الله بن السلام. I never heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم ever say one person that is living or walking upon the earth is in the Jannah other than Abdullah bin Salam. So the whole point is you have these ten who are the most virtuous, who have been given glad tidings of a Jannah. نعم. When it comes to specifically mentioning specific individuals in fadl, in virtue. وَلِكُلِّهِمْ قَدْرٌ وَفَضْلٌ صَاطِعٌ لَكِنَّمَا الصِّدِّيقُ مِنْهُمْ أَفْضَلٌ. Every single person has excellence. نعم. But each one of them, they differ when it comes to superiority and also virtuousness. So you have them ten. And also we have to understand, brothers, as a whole, جُمْلَةً, those that are most virtuous after the 10 asharat al-mubashirin is the muhajirin. Min hayth al-jumla, the muhajirin. Then you have the ansar, then you have the ahl-bada, ahlu bay'at al-ridwan, muhajirin, because they made hijrah to or with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll finish this off next week, otherwise I'm going to miss my train.